Thank you so much for listening to Pastor Cedric of Commitment Church. Our hope is to inspire, refresh, and encourage you to be lights in a dark world. This week, we continue a series called Everything You Do. If you do find this message inspiring or motivational, please follow Pastor Cedric or Commitment Church on Facebook and Instagram. Download our podcast on Anchor.fm, Pandora, Spotify, and other platforms. Now, filling in for Pastor Cedric, here's Pastor Ken Jones.
Hi, welcome. Thank you. I'm glad you're all here today. I'm Pastor Ken, one of the assistant pastors here at Commitment Church. Pastor Cedric is at a men's retreat in Lancaster, and so he asked me to substitute today for him. So I want to welcome you here and those that are watching online. We will be continuing in the sermon series, Everything I Do. And before I do anything, I'm going to ask God to intercede on my behalf and to work in our hearts today. So let's pray. Father, we are grateful and thankful that we can meet like this, in a place like this, to praise like this, to worship like this, and to read your word. Father, you are awesome, and we really want to now take some time to just reflect on who you are and who you can be in our lives if we would just allow you and allow your spirit to work. So I pray that you'll be with this sermon today, Father. I pray that it'll be your words and not mine, and that you'll speak to our hearts and our minds so that when we walk out these doors, we will be changed. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so the sermon series is called Everything I Do. And the purpose is to encourage the body of Christ to do everything and live every day for God's glory. We have a setting. I think we have some slides here. Cool. All right, so first, we live in a culture that pulls on us, luring and entangling our hearts to think we can rob God of the glory that is due only to him himself. This treachery, this trickery, inspired by Satan and enjoyed by our flesh, causes us to reach for something, which is God's glory, that is clearly unattainable and undeserved. So we must learn to navigate this real tension and somehow find a balance, doing everything and living every day for God's glory. Nevertheless, we must strive to do well in all areas of life, while humbly accepting life's benefits, yet persisting in doing well in and bringing all honor and glory to God and God alone. So hopefully we can mesh all this together and we can make sense out of all this. Four truths that we're going to talk about over a four-week period. Pastor last week talked about everything we do begins with our heavenly mindset. This week I'm going to talk about everything we do continues with our earthly and relational integrity. And then next week, Pastor Cedric will pick up with everything we do includes our private and family life. And lastly, everything we do should manifest in our marketplace presence. So we will be moving from Colossians, moving in Colossians chapter 3. So if you turn your Bibles there, please, Colossians chapter 3. And we'll start with verses 5 and 6. And there's five parts to how our integrity should look. And I should talk first about integrity. What is the concept of integrity? And I'm just going to leave you with a very simple definition. It's what we do when nobody's looking. We can all look good in front of people and say all the right Christian words. I used to do this all the time, so I know how this works. The pastor gets done preaching, and you know, you're spending some time with the pastor, and what do? You want to talk about Bible things. I want to talk about a devotion that I read or something that I heard in a sermon on the radio. I don't usually talk to them about how bad the Eagles are or other things like that. We don't get into regular conversations like you normally do with other people. You always seem to, I always seem to want to steer the conversation to Bible things, to holy things. And it was almost like me trying to show off how holy I was. But then I walk out the door and everybody else I talk to, I don't talk to them about nothing about the Bible. I'm talking about everything else that life has to bring. That's integrity. Mine was missing. And I realized that there was something that needed to change in my life and in my heart to be able to have integrity, to be the same person outside that I am inside. And that's what we want to talk about today. So verses 5 and 6 we'll start with in Colossians chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. And the point is here we have to live dead to sin. Verse 5 says, "Therefore, consider the members of your earthly body as dead to immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which amounts to idolatry. For it is because of these things that the wrath of God will come upon the sons of disobedience." A couple of definitions real quick. The word dead is to put to death, deaden, deprive of force and vigor, or mortify. And idolatry is service, worship, or covetousness. Kind of interesting. So first, we must consider the members of our earthly body as dead. The idea here is complete extermination, not regulation. Let me explain. Sometimes when it comes to sin, we tend to have categories. Different sins have different weights. And so we'll regulate the sin that's in our life instead of removing it completely. We might allow a little bit of sin here or a little bit of sin there because it's really not that bad. But it's still sin. And it needs to be exterminated. We are to become ruthless executioners of the old self. Let's go to Romans chapter 6, please. Romans chapter 6. And we're going to look at verses 1 through 7 and verse 11. Romans chapter 6, starting in verse 1. "What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin so that grace may increase? May it never be. How shall we who died to sin still live in it?" Now, Paul's answering a question here. Okay, the idea was that he was talking about in the previous chapter was about increasing the grace of God. And his grace is manifested when we are forgiven of our sin. So if we want more of God's grace, should we sin more? Kind of makes sense. No. And that's what Paul was trying to say. No, we can't do that because we're dead to sin. Verse 3 in Romans chapter 6. "Or do you now know that all of us who have been baptized in Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin." Verse 11 says, "Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus." So we've died with Christ through baptism. We talk about baptism in here. Well, you'll be doing baptism again in a couple of weeks. So keep your mindset going here, for those of you who haven't been baptized yet. Because in baptism, this is where we show that we identify with Christ by his death, burial, and resurrection. And it's our public display, if you will, our first opportunity to tell everybody that we know that we identify with Jesus Christ. The problem is we take that old self that got buried there and we give it artificial respiration and bring it back every once in a while. And we can't do that. We got to leave it dead. It is dead. We are no longer slaves to sin because the sin is powerless now because of the Holy Spirit of God that is dwelling within you. Sometimes I have friends of mine who are struggling with certain habitual sins. And I'll just try to tell them one of the ways that you can work your way through a habitual sin is imagine God doing it. We've all seen pictures of Jesus, right? I mean, there's all around. I'm sure everybody sees a picture. Imagine Jesus with a cigarette hanging out his mouth. It's kind of disgusting, isn't it, when you think about it? But yet every time we put a cigarette in our mouths, that's exactly what we're doing because we are the temple of the Holy Spirit of God. And if you read Scripture, if you understand Scripture, it's the Holy Spirit is God. Therefore, Jesus and God the Father are also dwelling within you. You know, now I always balk at a song that says, Holy Spirit, meet us here. And I keep thinking, I don't know about you guys, but he's already here because he walked in with me. I don't have to have him meet me here because he's already here. The problem is we quench that spirit. So we don't sense him. We don't feel him. So now we're looking for him. We don't have to. We got to let that old man die. And let him stay buried so that we become the new man. This whole process is called justification. And when I first put this sermon together, I had a whole definition for justification. I'm not going to do that because we'll be here until 3. But I want to tell you that just the simplest explanation, justification is just as if I never sinned. It's the easiest way to explain it. When you trust Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, that old self is so far gone, it's as if it never existed. I'll stop there. So we're to be dead to these sins: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, and evil desires. Now I'm going to give you a definition that's going to be real unpopular. God created sex to be enjoyed by one woman and one man within the confines of marriage. Any sexual activity that does not fit that definition is not to be part of a believer's life. Period. The Bible is extremely clear. Now, please don't misunderstand me. If someone is practicing a behavior that is immoral, does that mean they can't be saved? No, it doesn't. Salvation is for everybody. God ain't picky. If you come to him with your heart broken, recognizing that Jesus died for every single thing, sin that you commit, and you accept that, what is it? The ABCs, right? Accept, believe, and confess. That's how we become a Christian. The repentance part, the moving away from sin part, will come as the Holy Spirit of God indwells you and begins to work on your life. But those of us who are saved know the truth, and we need to practice it. Impurity is any unclean activity that is incompatible with the purity of our Savior. Greed is the desire, this is kind of cool. Greed is the desire to have more than one has, not because what we have is insufficient, but because others have more. You don't have to be rich to be greedy. We can be poor and be greedy, because greed is just wanting something we don't have. You got it? I want it. And I say that every time I see that black Mustang go by. And I have to ask for forgiveness because it's idolatry. Really, I mean, think about it. It's idolatry. Just like I want that bigger house, or on and on and on it goes. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, please. How are we going to deal with this stuff? 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 12 to 14 says, therefore let him who thinks he stands take heed that he does not fall. No temptation, note the word temptation, please. No temptation, it's not trial, okay? Just want to differentiate there. No temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man, and God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the way of escape also, so that you will be able to endure it. Therefore, my beloved, flee from idolatry. Run as fast as you can run. Now, please understand that verse 13 is not talking about trials in your life. God will allow trials in your life to test your faith and to draw you closer to Him and to learn to be more dependent upon Him, to grow your faith and to make you stronger. This verse is talking about temptation. That's why the very next verse says, flee idolatry. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, please. Verses 18 and 19. 1 Corinthians 6, 18 and 19 says, flee immorality. Every other sin that a man commits is outside the body, but the immoral man sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and that you are not your own? We all need to get in shape because we're going to do a lot of fleeing. Because we need to flee sin. James chapter 4, please. James chapter 4 and verse 7. Submit therefore to God. Resist the devil, and what's he going to do? He's going to flee the other way. This is so cool. So this is the whole concept of repentance. Repentance is you're going one way because you're living in sin, and you turn around, you start going in the opposite direction. And that's what we're doing. We are fleeing. We are fleeing from sin and from temptation and from Satan himself. And when we resist him, he runs the other way. So why are we stuck? I would like to suggest that spiritually we're out of shape. We ain't fleeing fast enough. And we're not resisting enough to make the devil go the other way. Earthly and relational integrity begins with a willingness, notice, a willingness to die to sin and fleeing idolatry. But we need the willingness to do so. Back to Colossians chapter 3, please, verses 7 and 8. Our next point is we need to be willing to admit who we were. Colossians 3, 7 and 8 says, and in them you also once walked when you were living in them, but now you also put them all aside, anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive speech from your mouth. Having come from an addictive personality of my own, I had the opportunity now to spend a lot of time dealing with other addicts. And one of the things I've learned in the process is that you can't help an addict who doesn't want to be helped. You can't help someone who's in sin who refuses to admit that they're in sin. It just don't work. In order to come to Christ, what do we need to do? We need to accept the fact and admit that we're sinners. So we have to come face to face with the fact that once that old man that's now dead and buried was really disgusting. Ephesians chapter 2, please. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 3. Among them we too all formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh, indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. Galatians 4, 8 and 9. However, at that time when you did not know God, you were slaves to those which by nature are no gods. But now that you have come to know God, or rather to be known by God, how is it that you turn back again to the weak and worthless elemental things to which you desire to be enslaved all over again? Don't we? Romans chapter 6. You're going to find me jumping back to Romans a lot. This sermon has got some good stuff. Romans chapter 6. We're going to look at verse 6, verse 16, and verse 20. Verse 6 says, knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin. Verse 16, do you not know that when you present yourselves to someone as slaves for obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey, either of sin resulting in death or of obedience resulting in righteousness. Verse 20, for when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. Have you noticed the operative word there? Slaves. We're slaves to whoever we obey. And if we choose to obey sin, we are slaves to that sin. When we choose to allow sin in our lives and to practice that sin that we know darn right well we shouldn't be, we're just showing the world that we're a slave to that sin. And if I'm going to be a slave, I want to be a slave to God. Earthly and relational integrity is being willing to admit who we once were. Back to Colossians chapter 3, please. We'll look at verses 9 to 10. Colossians chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. We're to be truly renewed. It says, do not lie to one another, since you laid aside the old self with its evil practices and have put on the new self, who is being renewed to a true knowledge according to the image of the one who created him. The word renew here is kind of interesting. It's to renovate. Change from a carnal to a Christian life and renewed completely by God. Completely. By God. The concept of putting on or putting aside is kind of interesting. It's the idea of removing and putting on clothes. So when we're to put aside the old self and put on the new, it's just like taking off a dirty shirt and putting on a clean one. It's really kind of that simple. The key to that is to remember that when you're wearing a dirty shirt, everybody knows it. And if you're putting on the clean one, they're going to know that too. And if we expect to have any kind of a witness for Jesus Christ, we can't do it when we're carrying around the old self and the old life and that old nature. And I'd like you to understand something, because we tend to make excuses. We do live in a world today where we want to blame everybody else but ourselves for our problems. And all you got to do is watch the news for a while and you get to see how anything that's going on in the world today is somebody else's fault. The problem is when we sin, it's our fault. It's not that old nature that's forcing us to sin. Let me put it to you this way. One of the things you get taught when you go to a rehab for alcohol is they tell you that you're an alcoholic because your parents were alcoholics. To which my response was, my daddy didn't open that bottle and pour the beer down my throat. I did that all by myself. When you sin, we sit there and go, well, you know, that's that old sin nature creeping back up in me again. That's a lousy excuse. Because we let that old sin nature come up and do that sin. Ladies and gentlemen, when you sin, it's because you choose to. You can't blame the devil. You certainly can't blame God. And your old nature is dead, remember? We buried that sucker. Romans chapter 6, please. Verses 20 to 22. It says, for when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. Therefore, what benefit were you then deriving from the things of which you are now ashamed? For the outcome of those things is death. But now, having been freed from sin and enslaved to God, you derive your benefit, resulting in sanctification, and the outcome, eternal life. Now, in this part of me writing this sermon, I had the whole thing for sanctification. I'm not going to do that either, or we'll be here till 5 o'clock. But understand the concept here. And I've said this before, salvation in three tenses. We're saved from what we've done in the past at the moment of salvation. When you trust Christ as Savior, everything you've done up until that point is dead, buried, and gone as if you never did it. But then while you're now walking with Christ, you sin. When you do, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We ask for forgiveness. He forgives us again. We're saved again from our own sin. That's sanctification. The outcome at the end is we're saved when Christ returns. We're saved from the wrath of God because we'll be in heaven when his wrath is being poured out on this earth. And that's glorification. So we're saved in three tenses. Okay? Right now, we are living in sanctification. We are living in that process where if we choose to sin, we can ask for forgiveness and God removes it, just as he removed the original sin that we had before we got saved. And as far as the east is from the west, it is gone. But through that process that we call sanctification, we should be sinning less and less. See, as we grow in Christ and as we become more in touch with that Holy Spirit that's living within us, the convictions become more and more and more. And your life becomes closer to God and more like Christ the more we grow. The problem is sometimes we stop feeding ourselves and we stunt our growth. So then we got to go back to the table and start getting some more of that spiritual nourishment that comes from the Holy Word of God. That's sanctification. So you got the whole three here in the short version. Sorry. But the outcome is eternal life. Therefore, earthly and relational integrity is when our renewal of sanctification in Christ is truly seen by all. Because we have taken off the old and put on the new. And everybody knows it. Back to Colossians chapter 3, please. We're going to go through verses 11 through 16. And the idea being here is that we are always wearing love. Colossians chapter 3, verse 11 says, a renewal in which there is no distinction between Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and freeman, but Christ is all and in all. So wearing love means we treat everyone the same. All barriers are abolished. Distinctions which normally divide people are abolished. And Paul mentions four distinctions here: racial, religious, cultural, and social. The racial is Greek and Jew. The religious is circumcised or uncircumcised. Cultural is barbarian or Scythian. And social is slave or free. These distinctions no longer have significance. I want to read you a paragraph I got out of a commentary that I thought was kind of interesting, but I think it's what we stand on here at Commitment Church. Because we're a place for all nations. The reason human categories no longer matter is that Christ is all, which means Christ is central and supreme. Our relationship with him is really all that matters. Unity within the community is based on the fact that Christ is in all. He indwells all believers and permeates all our relationships. This does not mean that people cease to be Jew or Greek, slave or free. It does mean that within the new community, these distinctions don't matter. The world is fond of dividing people into categories, like elite versus ordinary or spiritual versus not so spiritual. But the truth is, all believers are equal. And I am thrilled to be in a church that practices that every day. I have never, in the 15 years I've been in this church, ever felt like I didn't belong. Never. And I praise Cedric Brown for having the vision to start a church where he wanted all nations to come together, just the way that it says in the Bible, the way it's very clearly stipulated that we're to be like heaven here on earth. Y'all know this, man. And in heaven, there you don't have the Italian section and the Polish section and the black section back over here, and the Puerto Ricans are going to be back there. It don't work that way, man. We're all going to be together, singing the same song, in the same language, praising the same Savior, on our knees, together. Why ain't we doing it now? Well, we are here. Hallelujah. But what happens when we walk out the door and we get blasted by division? In every place we go, in every word we hear, constantly seeking to divide as if division will unite. I don't get it. What unites is Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ alone. We cannot legislate morality. We cannot legislate treating people right. It's in the heart of man. And the only thing that's going to change the heart of man is Jesus Christ. Amen. Why aren't we out there screaming it?
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Sorry. I get emotional. Verse 12 in Colossians chapter 3. So as those who have been chosen of God, holy and beloved, put on a heart of compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Verse 13, bearing with one another, one of my favorites, and forgiving each other, whoever has a complaint against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. Now the definition of bearing with is to have patience with in regard to the errors and weaknesses of anyone. Put up with them. It's really what it means. And this is, as I grow in Christ and as I, you know, begin to work in a church and take on leadership positions, I get frustrated. Because there's ministries that need to happen, and I need people in these positions, and I expect them to do certain things, and it doesn't happen, and you know, I go crazy. And then pastor will remind me, remember back when you were young in your faith? And I think, ooh, yeah, I do. And I was a mess. And somebody loved me through that so that I could grow in Christ. So we need to love each other through those tough times as we grow in Christ. The other key to this is to forgive as the Lord forgave you. Ooh, there's a tough one. Because what does the Lord do when he forgives? Right, he forgets. What do we do when we forgive? We remember to throw it back in your face later when you do it again. She's not here, so I'm okay, I can do that. We do, I mean, what do we say? That's human nature, right? Ooh, isn't it dead? So if that nature's dead, why do we keep remembering other people's sin? We're not called to do that. Like in the Lord's Prayer, we ask God to forgive us like we forgive others. Oops. We'd be in deep trouble if that happened. But that's all part of the unity and the compassion that we're to show, the forgiveness that we're to show. Verse 15. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, so to which indeed you were called in one body, and be thankful. So wearing love means that we're ruled by peace. If we're forgiving the way we're called to forgive, peace is just the natural next step. And there won't be that division in the body that Paul talks about in so many other places in Scripture. There'll be peace because we forgive. Verse 16, let the word of Christ richly dwell within you with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with thankfulness in your hearts to God. We need to wear love so that the word richly dwells in us. That means it's there. It's bubbling up and coming out of your mouth. And notice how, I love this. This is cool when he talks about music. I think we all understand the power of music. The tune can drive you emotionally, even if there's no words. The beat of a song will motivate you, even if there's no words. We need to be cautious about the words we stick in to that music. Because as that the tune is emotionally driving you, and as the beat is physically moving you, if it's not moving you towards Christ, you're going the wrong way. You're not fleeing the immorality and idolatry that we're called to flee. We're following right after that guy that's no longer fleeing us. Look, you either is, you ain't. Okay? You're either a Christian or you're not. There is no middle of the road, because if you're standing in the middle of the road, you're going to get run over. There's no fence to straddle, because you're going to fall off of it. Okay? I'm telling you, if you're in the middle, you're losing. You're losing the battle. And if you wonder why you can't stop sinning, it's because you haven't ran the other way. I try to tell people all the time, because I had to do this, okay? I have to admit this, man. I had to run. Oh, my goodness. My son gets on me all the time. When I finally surrendered my life to Christ, I took all of my secular music, threw it in a box, and put it out for the trash. I had a James Taylor original Flying Machine album.
Classic.
It's probably worth $1 million. It's gone. I threw it in the trash. But I had to, because I knew where my life was going to go if I went back to that music. I had to run from it as far as I could run and fill my heart and my ears and my mind with God's music. It was the only way I could be successful. I knew it. Music is powerful. Sit back here behind Norby sometime and watch the congregation as he's doing music. It's really fun to watch. I love being on the worship team because it's pretty cool. Because, man, folks, I mean, just get motivated by music. It just moves us. It really moves us. But it's got to be godly. 100%. Don't sneak off, because you leave place for the devil. And he'll sneak in that little crack and be right back in your head. Romans chapter 12, please. Verses 9 through 20. I'm going to read through these real quick if I find them. Romans chapter 12. And this is a nice little glimpse of what it looks like to wear love. It says, let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor. Not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer, contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice, and weep with those who weep. Be of the same mind toward one another. Do not be haughty in mind, but associate with the lowly. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Never pay back evil for evil to anyone. Respect what is right in the sight of all men. If possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. Never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. But if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him a drink. For in so doing, you will heap burning coals on his head. That's what love should look like. And then, of course, there's 1 Corinthians 13. We like to call it the love chapter. I'll just read four verses. 1 Corinthians 13, starting with verse 4. Love is patient, love is kind, and is not jealous. Love does not brag and is not arrogant, does not act unbecomingly. It does not seek its own, is not provoked, does not take into account a wrong suffered, does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails. And that's the love that we need to wear. And not just inside these walls, which you all do, because I've been the recipient of it. But when we walk out that door, we need to love the unlovely. How else will they know who we are if we only love those who love us? Because the love we're talking about here is that Christ-like love, that agape love, that can only be practiced through the power of the Holy Spirit. So earthly and relational integrity is when we're clearly clothed with and living in love. Verse 17 of Colossians chapter 3, please. And our last point is everything that we do is for the Lord. Colossians 3:17 says, whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. Now, the definition of word here is a saying, declaration, a sentiment uttered. It's both the act of speaking and the thing that's spoken of. And a deed is to act on something already done, whatever we undertake or attempt, our labor, business, or enjoyment. Matthew 12:36. But I tell you that every careless word that people speak, they shall give account for it in the day of judgment. We need to be careful what we say. 2 Corinthians 5:10. 2 Corinthians 5:10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. So our words and our deeds we will be judged for when we stand before Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6, verses 8 through 13. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again. Death no longer is master over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. Even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its lusts. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Now, I went to a seminar one time. I don't even remember what it was now. But one of the things, there's two things that the guy left with me that meant a lot to me that I practiced. The first one was, if you're tempted to sin, think of someone who Satan would hate to lose and pray for his salvation. Because then your mindset and your thought process changes. So I thought, well, that's kind of a cool idea. Let me try that out. So I had a buddy of mine who was a Marine, once a Marine, always a Marine, for you Marines out there. I knew there'd be one. I was a Zoomie, so. But he was the kind of guy to volunteer 3 times to go to Vietnam. He was a bit of a loon, a heavy drinker. He would walk into a bar, find the biggest guy he could find, beat him up so that everybody else knew he was the toughest guy in the bar. That's who he was. If he shook your hand, you pulled back a bloody stub, because he would try to see if he could break every bone in your hand. That's just the kind of man that he was. He actually would play the Star Spangled Banner at sunrise and put the flag up out on his front lawn. And at 5 o'clock, he would bring it down to taps every day. That's who this guy was. And I thought, now there's one Satan that hate to lose. I'm going to pray for his salvation. You know he got saved? Why did I doubt? Silly me. He got saved. I had the thrill to baptize him in somebody's swimming pool. And he became an elder in our church. What an unbelievable change of life took place because the Holy Spirit of God came inside this guy and just totally changed his life. And I'm thinking, why did I even doubt that? Well, I better go start praying for more people.
Do you think?
The other thing this fellow told us to do in this seminar was to memorize Romans chapter 6. Now, I would encourage you, and I know there's probably everybody sitting here going, I can't memorize that verse. Are you kidding me? And, of course, I'm going to tell you the same thing I tell teenagers. You know the verse to every stinking song on the top 40. And you're going to tell me you can't memorize a verse? Ha, ha, ha. Write it down. Again and again. And again, and that's exactly what I did. And I started every morning when I got up writing out the entirety of Romans chapter 6. And within a month, I had it memorized. And I didn't think I could do that. But if you want to die to sin and live to righteousness, you need to be reminded of it day after day after day after day. You need to read Romans chapter 6 and understand that we're dead. That old man is dead. He is gone. He is buried. And hallelujah, we're alive. I'm going to end with this. In the Old Testament, there's examples of four guys that were men of integrity. And the definition of integrity, when I looked it up, this is integrity as the Greek now, is honesty, sincerity, and singleness of purpose. So if you look at Genesis chapter 17, verse 1, the man Abraham is called perfect and blameless. In Genesis 25, 27, Jacob is called peaceful, plain, and content. Wouldn't we love to be content? 1 Kings 9, 4, David is said to be a man who have integrity of heart. And of course, Job 1, 1, perfect, upright, blameless, men of integrity. Now, Jesus didn't use the word integrity, but he calls for purity of heart in Matthew 5:8, singleness of purpose in Matthew 6:22, and purity of motive in Matthew 6:1-6. That's in your Engage homework, in case you're looking for it. We're called to be men and women of integrity, to be the same person outside these four walls that we are inside these four walls, to have the same interest, the same heart feeling, the same hand-raising worship outside these four walls that we have inside these four walls. I firmly believe that the issue comes is that we start reviving that old man when we put aside God's music and bring in the world's music, when we put aside the good news of the scripture and we listen to the bad news on Channel 6. And all of a sudden, that old man starts to resurrect again, and those old feelings and thoughts start permeating our lives. Let's put the old man down. Let's not give him mouth to mouth. Let's leave him dead, so that what dwells within you will come out screaming the love of Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you allow us to live in your love because you gave us the Holy Spirit of God to live within each one of us so that we could be convicted, we could understand scripture, we could practice the things that you call us to do because we are incapable in that old man. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will help each and every one within the sound of my voice today to crucify that old man once and for all, so that all that can be seen by anyone around is what you see when you see us, the righteousness of Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you again for listening to Pastor Cedric of Commitment Church. If you would like to learn more about Jesus Christ, please visit our website, www.commitmentchurch.org/start. This website will walk you through having a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Please let us know if you have made a decision to follow Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, or if you would like to support God's Word through this ministry by visiting www.commitmentchurch.org. You can also visit loveallnations.org for more information and to receive encouraging videos. Lastly, if you or your family reside in the South Jersey area, please visit us at 2 Berlin Road South, Lindenwald, New Jersey, 08021. May God bless you and have a wonderful day.